Welcome to the Saturday Morning Breakfast Mix, where we highlight the highs and lows of a particular Saturday morning cartoon and maybe some weekday ones that I, as well as many of us, grew up with, and to show why these awesome Saturday morning cartoons made weekends and weekdays just the best, and why seeing them now instantly brings back glorious memories of those carefree childhood days.
Mutation. It is the key to evolution. It has enabled a species to evolve from a single-celled organism into a dominant species in whatever heavenly body it inhabits. Although each case is different, with some mutations remaining dormant until activated by severe stress, others remaining unnoticed throughout a certain species' lifetime, and in some cases, these mutations are apparent immediately from birth. These mutations confer incredible abilities. But rather than being celebrated, many of these mutants are perceived as a threat to the status quo. Some hide away to avoid conflict, others strive for acceptance, but others become militant, taking on their oppressors head on. Freedom by any means necessary. It is within this war that a small group of individuals, gifted individuals, who are fighting for not just tolerance, but something greater, acceptance. These outsiders, these mutants, who are shunned from society rather than loved and generally embraced by the public, use their gifts to protect the world that hates and fears them. This is their story. X-Men, also known as X-Men the Animated Series, is a Canadian-American superhero animated television series which debuted on October 31, 1992 and ran through September 20th of 1997 on the Fox Kids Network for 5 seasons, totaling 76 episodes. The series itself has been recognized for being one of the most instrumental tools in boosting attention to the superhero genre that is still felt even to this day. Based on the popular comic book of the same name, the X-Men were the creation of the legendary Marvel duo of Jack Kirby and Stan Lee, who, on September of 1963, introduced the world to a very special group of people with superhuman abilities only known as mutants. Although the comic book was created in an era in Marvel that historians have dubbed the Silver Age of comics, by ushering in a new era filled with unique, interesting, and extremely popular characters, the X-Men were met with lukewarm reception, and the book was eventually cancelled in 1969. Although the character still existed within the Marvel Universe, guest starring in other books, there were no plans at the time of bringing them back in their own title. Even with its cancellation, the X-Men still had a very good amount of fans who would voice their displeasure of the book's cancellation and wanted it to return. As mentioned before, the book did not sell well compared to other titles like Spider-Man or the Fantastic Four, but was able to have its own dedicated fanbase. As the 1970s rolled out, it was the idea of then Marvel president Al Landau that they should create a comic book featuring a team with a very diverse cast as a way to reach an international market. Seeing as Landau came from a background of licensing Marvel comics to be sold in international markets, this idea proved to be what the X-Men needed in order to return. Upon the suggestion of writer and editor of Marvel Comics Roy Thomas, this new X-Men would feature two members from the original series, Scott Summers, Jean Grey, and introduce new characters from various places around the globe. Written by Len Wein and illustrated by Dave Cockrum, the all-new, all-different X-Men brought creative storytelling, introduced amazing characters, and creative universes that were totally different from various comic books of the time. The visual concept of the X-Men would not have been the way they were if not for these two talented individuals. The new team consisted of previously introduced characters like Shiro Yoshida of Agarashima, Japan, Sean Cassidy from the West Coast County Mayo, Ireland, both who were created by Roy Thomas and artists Werner Roth and Don Heck respectively. Next would be James Logan Howlett from Cold Lake, Alberta, Canada, who had been first introduced in the pages of The Incredible Hulk, issue number 180, created by Len Wein, Roy Thomas, John Romita Sr., and Herb Trump. And rounding off the team are the newly created characters and members of the team, Aurora Monroe from the Serengeti Plains of Kenya in Eastern Africa, Peter Nikolaevich Rasputin from Ust-Ordinsky Collective near Lake Baikal in Russia, John Proudstar from the Camp Verde Apache Reservation in Arizona, and last but not least, Kurt Wagner from Bavaria, Germany. Interestingly enough, while other members noticeably had very human features, Kurt, aka Nightcrawler, had a very dark, demon-like design, which in return told amazing stories because, like so many victims of prejudice, he's considered dangerous just because of how he looks, even though he's one of the good guys. Bringing such diversity and personalities with their own vast backstories to this comic book was something not seen at the time. Although the original readers of the past incarnation of the X-Men were not so much supportive of the change of cast for this new iteration, the new readers on the other hand were hooked with various letters being sent to Marvel offices expressing their love of this new team. As time went on, those old readers eventually started to change their opinion, and they too were in support of the creative team and their version of these now beloved characters. As Len Wein started to move away from his writing duties in X-Men, a young college intern working for Marvel as an assistant editor by the name of Chris Claremont jumped at the chance to write for the book. Seeing this as an opportunity to work alongside such a talented artist like Cockrum, young Claremont was relentless in his desire to be part of the creative team. It was during Chris Claremont's run of the book that the underlying mutant metaphor started to be placed in the forefront of the series. Using the mutant experience as a metaphor for prejudice, hate, and social acceptance was something that resonated so much with the readers of the book. As the readers themselves being teenagers to young adults at the time, it mirrored so many feelings and experiences that they themselves were going through in their own lives. In doing that, this created the strength of who these X-Men were and has become the core part of the series ever since. under the guidance of Dave Cockrum and Chris Claremont, whose collaboration would last over 16 years, the series grew in popularity worldwide, eventually becoming one of Marvel's most recognizable and successful franchises, spanning numerous spin-off X-books, video games, and television shows. We now know who was responsible for the comic's creation and popularity, but who were the individuals, or individual, responsible for bringing the X-Men to television? There was one person who made it possible, and that person was Margaret Loesch. Loesch, a former vice president then executive vice president for the Hanna-Barbera Productions, worked for Marvel Productions in 1984 as its president and chief executive officer, and was responsible for various programs like Transformers, G.I. Joe, Gem, Muppet Babies, Fraggle Rock, as well as countless other programs under that banner. One show that Margaret Loesch helped produce that is worth mentioning is the Pride of the X-Men television pilot. The half-hour special was the first attempt of a fully X-Men-oriented program. Considering that at the time, the X-Men characters were mostly used for guest appearances and other superhero shows. Originally premiering on the Marvel Action Universe television block in 1989, and rerun through syndication, Pride was poorly received and was not picked up. Although the pilot was praised for its high-quality animation, those who watched it felt that the pilot, for the most part, came across as too campy and didn't focus on the social issues that its comic counterpart dealt with, such as prejudice, intolerance, and racism. Once Margaret Loesch left Marvel Productions to become head of Fox Children's Network in 1991, her first order of business was to spearhead production for an X-Men series. Seeing that the X-Men comics and its characters told unique and compelling stories about prejudice, discrimination, and wanting to belong, as well as inspire those around them to be kind to their fellow man no matter what race, lifestyle, or way of life, was something that resonated with so much with Loesch that she made it her duty to tell these stories and honor not just the comics, but the people who made the X-Men one of Marvel's most popular and beloved franchises. Although at first there were various Fox executives that were against the idea, as they saw comic book properties being only something for only one demographic, the comic readers and no one else, thankfully, Margaret Loesch wasn't alone, as she had support from television producer and vice president of the Fox Kids Network, Sidney Wanter, to back her up in getting the series made, with Loesch vowing not to make the same mistakes that Pride of the X-Men had made. Outside of the 1978 Incredible Hulk television series, Marvel at the time only had moderate success in television and almost no success in film. So you can see why these senior executives, advertisers, and station owners were hesitant about making the series. But Loesch believed in the show and put her career on the line to get the show made.
I waited one season because we had so much to get done, and then I told my boss, I'm gonna order X-Men, and he said, uh-uh. And I was really taken aback. I said, well, I thought I had green light authority here and I could make the creative decisions. He said, Margaret, I think that X-Men is a mistake. Why do you believe in it so much? And I told him all the reasons. He says, well, I don't know. I don't really. He says, and I don't see any enthusiasm from you. And I said, well, my enthusiasm is for the shows, not for... I really believe in it. And so he thought it was a mistake. He thought that, again, a comic book, maybe it was too esoteric. I can't remember all the reasons he didn't like it. But he said to me, okay, Margaret, I'll let you do it, but you understand if it doesn't work, it's not going to work for us together here. He said, are you willing to put that much behind the show? And I said, yeah.
And with that, the X-Men were given a second chance. 13 episodes of the X-Men were ordered to be made for the Fox Kids network. Now it's off to find those that would bring this series to life. Loesch would bring in Haim Saban of Saban Entertainment, as well as Grants Entertainment, to produce the show. However, they did not have sufficient staff to do the entire series in-house as contracted, so they brought in South Korean studio Acom to help with the animation duties for the show. Next, they hired Eric Lewald to be the executive story producer. Eric, along with his wife Julia, had experience in writing for popular animated television shows, with their previous bodies of work being Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers, The New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh, Tailspin, Beetlejuice, Darkwing Duck, and Gargoyles. With such an amazing body of work, they were the right people for the job. Although Eric and Julia were not comic book fans, they do credit their lack of knowledge combined with what the characters represented to have benefited the series. At the time, the X-Men were relatively unfamiliar outside the comic book realm, and Lewald's distance helped the series connect with new audiences by simply telling great and amazing stories. Both Eric and Julia worked with Bob Harras, a writer and editor-in-chief for Marvel at the time, whose works include various comic books, including the X-Men, to fill the staff for the series with experienced comic book individuals. One being an animator and storyboard artist, Will Mignot, who had extensive accolades in both film and television with projects like the aforementioned Hulk television series, Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends, Real Ghostbusters, Batman the Animated Series, Exo Squad, Gem, as well as countless other projects, and was storyboard director and producer for the Pride of the X-Men television pilot. Another animator who worked as producer for the Pride of the X-Men pilot that was added to the team was Larry Houston. With notable works that include Dundar the Barbarian, G.I. Joe, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Spawn, Mighty Orbots, as well as Batman the Animated Series, Real Ghostbusters, and Gem alongside Will Mignot, and countless other programs, Mr. Houston was definitely someone you would want in your team helming the director's chair. Alongside his vast comic book knowledge from reading the works of the legendary Marvel comic team of Jack Kirby and Stan Lee in his youth, he was the perfect choice for creating a fusion of fanboy fun and action into this animated program. Everyone involved knew that the characters needed to be taken seriously despite varying tones in the comics, especially if they were to compete with an already well-received and super popular cartoon in the form of Batman, the Animated Series. Sidney Wanter would go as far as referencing music styles in order to separate the X-Men cartoon from their DC Comics Warner Brothers rival. So while Batman, the Animated Series cartoon was considered cool jazz, the X-Men were hard rock. Finding the right tone proved to be difficult for the producers of the show. They wanted to be serious in telling adult stories in a children's medium, a task that can be very difficult when translating something from one medium to another for such a younger audience. Thankfully, because of having people like Eric Lewald and his wife Julia on board, they were able to put a very strong effort into mirroring what goes on in the comics and also not skew it so much that it alienated the comic fans that knew and loved these characters, while also bringing in new fans to the series discovering these characters and stories for the very first time. Although all the characters mattered and had unique powers that would tell amazing stories, both Eric and Julia thought it was necessary to keep the main cast small in order to assure that the series would work within its 22-minute television time frame. Once the amount of main characters were decided upon, 9 in total, excluding villains and supporting characters, it was up to deciding who would help elevate these stories. The obvious was, of course, Charles Xavier because of the ideals he represented. Rogue was chosen because of her mutant abilities to absorb strength and memories. given her a sense of isolation, for she could never touch anyone and remain distant for fear of hurting anyone around her. Storm was selected for the powers of controlling the elements, but more importantly because of how she carried herself and what she represented, a sense of majesty. She brought beauty and a sense of dignity to what the team was all about. Although Beast was brought in as a way to stand out from the other X-Men, similar to how Nightcrawler was in the comics for having features that would set him aside from his normal-looking comrades. It was his thoughtful personality and kindness that would help represent the X-Men in what their cause was both noble and just. Wolverine was the obvious choice to include because of his popularity, but also what he represented, and that was the fury and frustration of the unjustly oppressed. Cyclops was selected as the leader because of his doubtful demeanor, a character that was motivated by duty rather than desire or enthusiasm. It was something that made him stand out from the various individuals that were usually given that title. Jubilee was selected for her curious nature and in return represented the disenfranchised youth who always felt out of place and ill at ease. An allegory for those discovering the X-Men for the first time and the various types of discrimination that the team and her fellow mutants would face on a daily basis. Gambit, although still new to the X-Men comic book universe but very popular upon debuting, was pushed by Marvel to be part of the team, and with this addition he represented a charming personality that upon further investigation revealed a very troubling past, and in return his loyalties were perpetually in question, making him the wild card of the team. Get it? Wild card? Because... Never mind. And finally, the one that held it all together was Jean Grey, who is almost like a motherly figure to the team by helping the various members of the team with their personal issues. What is most important to having her in the team is the fact that she brings out the humanity to two particular members of the team, Wolverine and Cyclops. For Cyclops, an individual who possesses an immense power that could destroy anything by merely just looking at it. An individual who is so disciplined in controlling his gift in hopes of not hurting others that he is not really being free to enjoy life. Because of Jean, Scott can finally realize that his powers don't have to define him, resulting in Cyclops coming out of the barriers he created for himself and actually living life to the fullest. For Wolverine, a ferociously abused individual as a result of the experimentation he suffered at the hands of the Weapon X program, finds his compassion for another person because of Jean Grey, and in turn enables him to care for others on the team and rekindle the humanity he lost. An individual intended to be an unemotional assassin at first, he is now capable of reconnecting with his past and able to become someone the team can depend on. This would also result in a love triangle involving these three individuals, something definitely that was featured in the comics, which brought about some conflicts that were never seen at the time, especially for what Fox executives thought was a cartoon for children. At the time, Marvel and the people bringing the cartoon to life butted heads in the selection of the look of the team. As the show featured a similar look and lineup to the early 90s incarnation drawn by then Marvel comic artist Jim Lee, Marvel wanted to change the look of the characters. As Lee left Marvel to form Image Comics, Marvel had ordered the producers to remove all of Lee's visual influence. This did not bode well for the team making the cartoon, as they felt Lee's costume designs were needed in making sure each member looked unique for representing a more modern look and feel to the show, considering it was telling 30-year-old stories to a much more current audience. This decision to stick with the Jim Lee-inspired look was championed by Will Mignot and Larry Houston, who, amongst many back-and-forth fights between them and those at Marvel, would ultimately prevail, with Marvel eventually relenting and allowing them to use that look for the characters. The entire cast was chosen and recorded in Canada, as Fox Kids had looked there before with the Beetlejuice cartoon. This decision proved well for them, as the show had a very limited budget compared to various other cartoons, and was cheaper when dealing with residual payments. The difference between Canadian and American voice actors being that Canadian voice actors are not paid for reruns, but American actors are paid each time an episode airs. Compared to Batman the Animated Series, the X-Men cartoon had a very much smaller budget and did not have as much of the substantial resources and production time to what Warner Brothers had for its show. This, along with production delays, moved the premiere of the X-Men cartoon to the end of October instead of its original September Labor Day weekend debut. The Night of the Sentinels two-part episode originally aired as a sneak peek on October 31st of 1992, with its third episode, Enter Magneto, airing just 2 weeks afterwards. The first two episodes and its noticeable animation errors and production delays upset many of those in Fox that were involved with the show, ultimately resulting in Fox threatening to break off their contracts with Acom. Thankfully, this course of action convinced Acom to correct their mistakes and get the show back on track with a full run, beginning with its fourth episode, Deadly Reunions, on January 23rd of 1993, and continuing every Saturday afterwards, completing its 13-episode season. As the first episode begins, we are shown TV news footage of a large individual by the name of Sabretooth attacking police forces. As this attack continues, a news reporter covering this occurring development informs the audience watching at home that this random attack is one of many, indicating a time of unrest between mutants and humans. These attacks are doing nothing but fueling the anti-mutant hysteria that seems to be spreading across the nation at a rapid pace. Elsewhere, we're introduced to a couple who have had enough of this shocking development and turn off the TV in the realization that their adopted daughter, Jubilee, might be one of those dangerous mutants that they hear so much about. It is then that we discover that Jubilee's adopted father has recently registered the young teen for the Mutant Control Agency, an organization designed to support mutants that he believes to be an outreach program to help unfortunate individuals. As the couple embraced in the fact that they have no other option for protecting their adopted daughter, we discover that the person in question, Jubilee, has been overhearing the conversation for quite some time. Wondering why such a thing would happen to her, with shock and confusion running through her mind because of this revelation, this young individual, this mutant, can do nothing but cry. In the distance, we see a large figure approaching Jubilee's location, scanning the nearby buildings as it walks along the street, ever nearing its destination. This towering figure, a large robot designed to police, fight, and capture mutants, a sentinel. Finding its designated location, the robot peeks in the window of Jubilee's room. With its eyes illuminating the room, the sentinel robot smashes its arm through the window and grabs the bed with what he thinks is the sleeping teenager, only to discover that there are no living objects inside. Casting the bed away, the imposing robot begins a tracking program and stomps away, with the screams of Jubilee's adopted mother being heard upon seeing what remains of her daughter's room. We soon discover that Jubilee is at the local mall. Depressed at the thought that her adopted parents might not have really loved her, the young teen finds comfort in distracting herself at the arcade. But little does she know that the massive sentinel has tracked her down. Just as she wonders what is wrong with being a mutant, Jubilee's mutant powers begin to manifest itself, completely destroying the game she was playing. As a crowd gathers to see the commotion, the arcade's manager angrily asks if she knows how much those machines cost, with Jubilee only retorting with a sarcastic remark.
Hey you! Do you know how much that game costs? Yeah, a quarter.
It is when the arcade manager realizes that she is one of them, a mutant, that Jubilee decides to run away, accidentally bumping into X-Men members Storm and Rogue, who were coincidentally shopping at the time. After yelling at the two women to look where they are going, Jubilee continues her journey and leaving the mall. But such venture is halted as the Sentinel robot has entered the mall with waves of screaming mall patrons running for their lives. Identifying its target, the Sentinel apprehends Jubilee, but is suddenly halted as Storm, mistress of the elements, introduces herself and commands the robot to release the girl. Unable to identify either of these two individuals, the Sentinel continues its purpose in retrieving Jubilee, but in doing so is left open to an attack from the mistress of the elements. As Jubilee is safely carried away from the Sentinel, the X-Men member known as Rogue begins her attack, bombarding the massive robot with her feats of strength, but before anything is resolved, the two women are blasted through the skylight above and onto the roof. As the chase once again continues for the Sentinel and Jubilee, the young mutant is saved by another member of the X-Men, Gambit. Not knowing what is happening, Jubilee runs away with Gambit calling out to her since he, a fellow mutant, wants to help, but this decision proves to be his undoing as he is quickly blasted and left unconscious. As the Sentinel sees the downed Gambit and declares him expendable, the young Jubilee steps out from behind a column she was hiding in and blasts the towering machine, leaving it in a staggered state, both saving Gambit and also giving her the time she needs to escape. Heading towards the parking lot of the mall, the Sentinel robot releases a canister from its hand containing knockout gas onto Jubilee. With the knockout gas taking effect, we see Jubilee stumbling upon a man in a blue and yellow uniform and a visor who makes quick work in incapacitating their pursuer.
Energy blast, huh? Here's one from a pro.
As time passes and the effects of the gas have finally worn off, we see Jubilee waking up in a place she is not familiar with. Using her powers to escape, the young mutant roams the vast halls of this unfamiliar location in hopes of finding a way out unnoticed, but not before peeking into two other mutants, Beast and Morph, who reside within this labyrinth of technology. Finding a room filled with various monitors, all reporting various mutant activity, one of these reports in particular, angering the young Jubilee, comes in the form of Senator Robert Edward Kelly, in which he urges the press that they need to treat all mutants as potential danger to mankind. Hearing approaching voices, Jubilee continues on towards her escape, but it brings her unwanted attention as Jean Grey, along with Professor Charles Xavier, notice that the monitor she left on had been somehow turned off. Using his powers of telepathy, Professor Xavier discovers that this was Jubilee's doing and now knows she is trying to escape. As Jubilee flees with alarms blaring in the background, she is stopped by a large door. Not wanting to get captured, the young mutant finds her way inside in hopes of hiding, but we soon realize this is no ordinary room. Surprised and horrified for what she is encountering in this danger room, Jubilee is found by Gambit, who warns her that this room is no place for her to be. But before anything else could be said, their nearby wall collapses, revealing another member of the X-Men, Wolverine. As the two mighty mutants battle amongst themselves, the young Jubilee can do nothing but watch in horror as Wolverine is the victor, lying atop his fallen prey about to land the final blow. Before anything else can happen, Jubilee orders Wolverine not to hurt him, and in that quick distraction, she is able to use her mutant powers to knock him off and into the wall. As the dust settles and the door opens, Storm, Beast, and Morph enter to survey the situation, with Beast assuring that what she witnessed was not a fight to the death, but one of the various training sequences that are part of what they call the Danger Room. Still confused on what is happening, Storm explains to Jubilee that the purpose of the X-Men is to fight for peaceful existence between mutants and humans, with Storm reassuring her that they are safe and that they learned to control their powers to help mankind, thanks to the teachings of their leader, Charles Xavier. Back at the control room, we discovered that the retrieved visual data of the Sentinel robot comes from the Mutant Control Agency's registration files. This realization leaves more questions than answers, as this must mean that someone at the agency must have a hidden agenda. Back at Jubilee's home, we are introduced to Henry Peter Gyrick, who is seen questioning her adopted parents in hopes of discovering who the mysterious mutants helping her at the mall were. As this is happening, we see Jubilee running in the direction of her home in hopes of assuring that her adopted parents are safe, but is suddenly spotted and confronted by two Sentinel machines and ultimately captured. Back at the mansion, Professor Xavier explains that the Mutant Control Agency's headquarters has files on hundreds of registered mutants who were innocently deceived into revealing their identities, and in order to protect them from future attacks similar to Jubilee, that they must infiltrate the building and destroy the files. Having doubts about doing this mission, Cyclops confronts the professor on taking such a high-risk mission, for there must be a better way to handle the situation. But alas, they have no other choice if they are to protect those who might be in mortal danger. With Wolverine accusing Cyclops of getting cold feet in leading the mission, the two X-Men almost come to blows. However, they are interrupted by Jean Grey, who alerts them that Jubilee is missing. Deciding that he will be the one who will search for Jubilee, Wolverine is then halted by Cyclops and reminded that they have a mission to carry out. But sadly, this command falls on deaf ears, as Wolverine simply states, he goes wherever he wants. Arriving at the Mutant Control Agency's headquarters, the X-Men survey the area in hopes of finding out what they are up against. They are soon joined by Wolverine, as he had no luck in tracking Jubilee's trail once he exited the mansion. Using their abilities to get past security, the X-Men are easily able to reach their destination. With guards and their weapons on hand on the other side of the door, the lives of our unsuspecting heroes are in danger. Thankfully, because of Wolverine's heightened senses, they are able to avoid what would have been their untimely end. Meanwhile, outside the Mutant Control Agency, we see that Gambit, Rogue, and Cyclops confront the armored vehicles that have arrived at the building. Back inside the building, thanks to a clever disguise by Morph, we see that the other X-Men members have arrived at the Mutant Registration File Room and are quick to assure the information it houses is properly destroyed. At the same time, in an abandoned automobile factory in Detroit, Michigan, the captured Jubilee is questioned on her knowledge of the X-Men by Henry Gyrick. It is then that we introduce to Gyrick's partner and person responsible for designing and building the Sentinel robots, Bolivar Trask, who interrupts the interrogation of the young mutant to remind Gyrick that the plan was not to strike any mutants until they had 100 of the Sentinels fully operational and ready to attack. Before anything else happens, Gyrick is alerted of the attack happening at the Mutant Control Agency and gives out the command to eliminate the mutant threat. Back at the agency, the confrontation between the X-Men and the armed guards rages on, with the team doing their hardest to ensure the safety of the remaining members inside the building while not harming the soldiers attacking them, as they are en route to completing their mission. Cyclops is alerted to the mission being successful and orders everyone to return to their jet, the Blackbird. However, that is easier said than done, as a legion of Sentinels arrive to assist in the conflict. Seeing as Wolverine is clearly outnumbered, Morph cries out for Wolverine to pull back. But before we discover what happens next, we cut to Jean Grey, monitoring the mission through Cerebro, suddenly crying out in pain. Not sensing Morph's life signal, both Professor Xavier and Jean confirm that one of their members is gone. As time passes, we see that the remaining X-Men have arrived back at the mansion, bringing with them more emotional scars than physical ones as a result of what happened back at the Mutant Control Agency. Wolverine, one of the most vocal members of the team, makes his thoughts on the matter known to the leader of the group by sucker punching him and berating him for his poor judgment. Just then, before the situation could reach conflict, Jean Grey appears, with Wolverine arguing that Morph and Beast could possibly still be alive. Realizing that Beast is still alive, but not Morph, Wolverine storms out in frustration, but not without expressing his anger the only way he can. Even with the assurance from Jean Grey that what happened back at the Mutant Control Agency was not anyone's fault, Wolverine drives away with the thoughts of what happened back at the agency running through his mind.
I'll avenge you, my friend. I swear it.
Sometime later, we see the now captured Beast being confronted by Gyrick, who hopes to get any information regarding the X-Men. But his request is angrily denied by Beast as he is currently in mourning of his fallen friend and comrade, Morph. Later, we see that various news outlets are reporting on the attacks at the New Salem Mall and the Mutant Control Agency. Interestingly enough, it is here that we find out that the Mutant Control Agency's databases were part of the government-operated Federal Security Agency, which in turn would make what the X-Men had done a federal crime. At a local bar, Logan has had enough of the news broadcast and wishes to play his game of pool in peace, but certain individuals find this to be the perfect time to pick a fight with an already riled up Canuck. Just as a fight is surely to occur, Cyclops intervenes and convinces Logan into a plan on how they can locate the Sentinels' home base. Meanwhile, at the White House, the President has a meeting with Gyrick and orders him and his partner, Dr. Trask, to stop anything involving their privately run mutant registration program, for she questions as to why a group of mutants would sacrifice their lives to destroy his files and what were they afraid of to take such action. Walking out in anger, Gyrick is contacted by Jubilee's foster father, who is then advised to keep his visitor there as long as he can. That visitor, X-Men member Cyclops. Being guilt-ridden with what he is doing upon the revelation that it was the Sentinels that kidnapped their adopted daughter, Jubilee's father explains that Gyrick and company told them that if anyone came asking about Jubilee, to contact them immediately. Scott, reassuring him that he did nothing wrong and just wanted to help Jubilee, leaves the house and comes face to face with the Sentinel robot that was sent to deal with him. Blowing off the Sentinel's arm by way of his optic blast, the massive robot announces that it will return to base for repairs with all the remaining X-Men members following hot on his trail. Back at the abandoned automobile factory, Gyrick informs Trask about the government's cancelled support of their mutant registration, and he fears that the Sentinel program might be next. Just then, both men are interrupted by the sound of an approaching Sentinel, who crashes down, damaging some equipment and shutting off the power to the cell that was housing the kidnapped Jubilee. Using this as her opportunity to escape, Jubilee blasts away the walls that once imprisoned her, but just before she can go any further, she is confronted and surrounded by various Sentinel machines. Just then, a familiar voice is heard and a blast of energy knocks down three of the Sentinels, with both Gyrick and Trask escaping amongst the ensuing battle, promising that their work is just beginning. Fighting as a team and using their gifts, the X-Men confront the threat that has been a constant source of trouble for them and emerge victorious. After the Sentinels are defeated and Jubilee rescued, we see the young mutant making one of the most important decisions in her life. Deciding that it would be best to stay at the Xavier Mansion in hopes to better control her abilities and protect those she loves, Jubilee waves goodbye to her foster parents and is on her way towards a new future. But even in that, with Jubilee arriving at the mansion with positive intent, a shadow of doubt still looms in the air in the form of the group's leader. It is here that we see that Scott still wonders if the choice he made back at the Mutant Registration Center involving Beast and Morph was the right thing to do. In his current situation, Jean Grey can only console her teammate and lover by reassuring him that he did what he had to do, and so did they. But these are just one of many interesting stories, situations, characters, groups, and threats, both human and mutant and otherworldly, that the X-Men would encounter for the cartoon's original 76 episode run. Battling various hate organizations, villains, and supervillains along the way, who were always bent on destroying our heroes and the message they represented to fulfill their own selfish, unjustifiable needs, was just something that resonated with so many viewers who themselves experienced prejudice in one way or another. Sure, the show contained various situations that might not be really within the realm of reality, but it was the message and story being told within those conflicts that have stood out through the test of time. The stories told in this series were also very groundbreaking, as it's considered one of the very first animated series to have ongoing stories. Before X-Men, shows were episodic, focusing only on the weekly story. Most stories would be wrapped up by the end of the episode and have little to no effect on the subsequent stories. X-Men, however, was different, for it was the first to create continuity between the episodes, creating a larger story. And in that, it was able to create complex stories with drawn-out character arcs that continued throughout its seasons. Oh, did you know? That at first, Beast was one of the X-Men characters that Marvel did not vouch for when the members of the initial team were selected for the series. Thankfully, the team behind the series found a way to include him in the series' first season as a guest character, which would explain why his appearance is barely minimal after the initial two pilot episodes. Having him incarcerated throughout the remainder of the first season, with few segments being shown throughout various episodes, gave an overarching story of his imprisonment and gave attention to his beliefs that true justice will prevail. With the subplot of Beast facing trial being sprinkled throughout the first season, this gave weight to the stories being written, as before X-Men, shows at the time were episodic, which would mean that whatever the major story was in a cartoon show, that it would be wrapped up by the end of the episode and have little to no effect on subsequent stories going forward. With the background story of Beast's imprisonment, the show displays story threads that continued throughout the first and subsequent seasons, ultimately ending the first season with Beast given full pardon by then-President Robert Kelly and becoming a full-fledged member of the team, thanks to an agreement by Marvel and the series developers by the first season's end. The character of Morph was created specially for the series. In fact, he was designed specifically to be killed off in order to show how serious the show was compared to other cartoon shows and various dangers that the team would face. It was partially based on an existing Marvel character by the name of Changeling. The character was chosen because of his past ties to the X-Men, as well as his deceased status in the current comics. He was practically considered a blank slate, so the writers were able to use him without the fear of any fan backlash. Interestingly enough, because of the cartoon's popularity, that character itself became so popular that he came back in the Age of Apocalypse story event and later on into the Exiles comic series under his new codename, Morph. The series was also one of the first in an American animated series to feature a large number of female members on the team, with the women making up 4 of the 9 initial members. At the time, most series would feature mostly men with 1 or 2 women. Although certain executives of the series were resistant to gender equality, as they considered the series as something made for boys and that boys wouldn't watch female heroes. Thankfully, Margaret Loesch was a key figure in pushing those petty requests aside, and allowing Eric Lewald and the team to focus on writing the most intense stories they could, as they felt having mostly men with 1 or 2 women would have weakened the stories they were writing. The inclusion of the Sentinels allowed the series to sidestep broadcast censor problems. Seeing as they couldn't show characters like Wolverine using their abilities on actual living things on the show compared to their comic book counterparts, the Sentinels were used in a way to both display and elevate the action while also not breaking any rules brought into by the television broadcast standards and practices. When the series debuted in Japan on TV Tokyo from 1994 through 1995, both the animated intro and outro, as well as the legendary theme song for the show by Ron Wasserman, was replaced with a completely different theme and animation in order to attract the Japanese viewers. Replacing it with a more action-oriented theme by the rock group Ambience, the title track Rising gave way to a more action-oriented sequence that would garner anyone's attention. Interestingly enough, back in the States, where the series had ended its run and reruns would run through syndication, the anime opening was used as the ending credits sequence with Ron Wasserman's theme playing over it. During its initial airing, X-Men garnered very high ratings for a Saturday morning cartoon, and similar to Batman the Animated Series, it received a wide critical praise for its portrayal of many different storylines from the comics by its fans. Haim Saban even credits the success of the series in assisting him to sell his next project to Fox, an adaptation of Toei's Super Sentai series Kyoryu Sentai Zyuranger, under its new name, the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. The show was originally planned to run for 65 episodes, but given its success and Marvel's bankruptcy, Saban funded the additional episodes, with Philippine Animation Studio Inc. and Hong Ying Animation providing the animation for the series' final season. The success of the X-Men helped usher in various Marvel comic book shows in the 1990s like Iron Man, The Incredible Hulk, Fantastic Four, Silver Surfer, and the now legendary Spider-Man, the animated series, to various networks. And on that note, Spider-Man did make a brief cameo in the actual X-Men cartoon before his own cartoon had premiered. In the Phoenix Saga Part 5, Child of Light, Spider-Man's hand could be seen shooting a web to save someone. This episode aired just 2 months before the premiere of Spider-Man, the animated series. Furthermore, as a way to show that these characters indeed live in the same shared universe, all of the X-Men do make an appearance in the Spider-Man animated series episodes titled The Mutant Agenda, and The Mutant's Revenge. X-Men member Storm would also later appear in the first 3 chapters of the Secret Wars story arc. Prior to this crossover, the X-Men also appeared in another Spider-Man related cartoon, Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends. These episodes being The Origin of Iceman, A Firestar is Born, and The X-Men Adventure. These guest appearances were made possible as team member Iceman was part of the Spider-Friends along with his fellow mutant member, Firestar. As mentioned before in my previous video covering the 1966 Marvel superheroes, the X-Men's first appearance into the world of animation was during the Submariner segments titled Dr. Doomsday, The Doomed Alliance, and Tug of Death. The original story was an adaptation of Fantastic Four issue number 6, but since Grant Trey Lawrence Animation did not own the rights to the Fantastic Four, as it was currently being held by Hanna-Barbera, the producer substituted the X-Men instead. Although the episode renamed them as the Allies for Peace, the team retained their original designs and individual names from the comics, featuring the lineup of Professor Charles Xavier, Angel, Beast, Cyclops, Iceman, and Marvel Girl. Interestingly enough, Kitty Pryde was one of the few characters not to make any cameo appearance, and the only major X-Men not to appear throughout the series' 76 episode run. Seeing as she had been the center of Pride of the X-Men pilot that failed to take off, those involved in Marvel at the time feared that the character was to blame for the less than enthusiastic reaction to the pilot, resulting in it not being picked up as a series. Ultimately, this decision resulted in Kitty Pryde never appearing throughout the cartoon's development and subsequent ending. This, thankfully, didn't last forever, as she would become a major part of the comics again and even appear in future X-Men animated programs such as X-Men Evolution and Wolverine and the X-Men as one of its main protagonists. As mentioned before, Marvel had little to no success adapting their characters from one medium to another, with various films and television series failing to make an impact throughout the mid-80s and 90s. While various studios were trying their hands in adapting these larger-than-life characters, the results varied from either the lack of big Hollywood funding in order to get the special effects needed to give the characters life, or completely ignoring the heart of the character that made them so popular in the first place, resulting in some cancelled projects or straight-to-video films that, although have become guilty pleasures and achieved cult status, are seen as forgotten failures. Although the failure of transitioning their established characters to the big screen was halted for the time being for Marvel, they continued to have slightly better success on the animation front. But it wasn't until the success of the X-Men cartoon that interest would once again occur in bringing Marvel's most popular heroes to life, all thanks to Margaret Loesch pitching the idea for an X-Men movie to the higher-ups at Fox. With producer Lauren Shuler Donner being contacted and seeing how the X-Men differ from other comic book superheroes with their grounded characters and the themes of prejudice and repression, the X-Men rights were bought in 1994 and now were in the hunt for a director. With the success of 1995's Usual Suspects by Ryan Singer, many studios were looking to work with the director, and thanks to a suggestion by his creative partner Tom DeSanto, who was a big fan of the comics, Brian was hired on board as the one to helm the director's chair, as DeSanto felt that he would be the one to tackle the social themes with his unique narrative structure and cinematic techniques. While preparing for the first X-Men film, Bryan Singer immersed himself by watching the entire cartoon series, which was definitely a time saver, as reading the 40-year-old comic book history of these characters and their adventures would have been a massive undertaking. In doing this, Bryan Singer was able to appreciate and discover the crux of the characters. The various conflicts involving racism, bigotry, and the underlying themes of tolerance throughout their everyday lives that the comics and more importantly the cartoon were able to tell so well resulted in Eric LaWald and Will Mignot being brought in as consultants for the first film. With an original script by Ed Solomon which had to be rewritten by Singer and his Usual Suspects partner Christopher McQuire, as well as additional writing duties from David Hayter,
kept you waiting, huh?
Yes, that David Hayter, the X-Men movie was a go. Hiring a cast of prominent actors as well as some small and unknown ones, especially in the case of Hugh Jackman, who was a suggestion at the behest of his friend Russell Crowe, who was originally contacted to play the part of Logan, aka Wolverine. The X-Men started production in mid-1999 with the release of Christmas of the following year with an estimated budget of $75 million. Additionally, George Buzza, who was the voice of Beast in the animated series, auditioned for a small part in the film before the producers of the film found out that he had a connection to the cartoon and was given a small role playing a truck driver who helps the young runaway rogue, played by Anna Paquin, across the Canadian border. Another connection to the cartoon was actor David Hemblen, who provided the voice for Magneto in the series. The actor was a finalist to reprise his role for the live-action adaptation, but sadly had to pull out due to scheduling conflicts with the Earth Final Conflict television series, ultimately losing the role to Ian McKellen, who had worked with Singer on his previous film, Apt Pupil. The development of the film came across a bit of a problem as Fox needed a film to fill out the summer release slate, as the slot was originally intended for Minority Report, but was delayed as that film's director Steven Spielberg decided to film AI instead, resulting in the X-Men movie that was originally supposed to premiere on Christmas of 2000 to June of that same year. This decision resulted in the film losing about 6 months worth of filming with even less post-production time. But those behind the movie were able to convince the higher-ups at Fox to push their release date to July in order to have the film fully completed. Although the idea of using the brightly colored superhero outfits was discussed, the producers ultimately decided that those outfits would not look good on film for the modern audiences they were trying to attract, resulting in the black leather outfits being chosen as a way to separate themselves from what they felt would have made the film look too campy or goofy. Even with the rushed production schedule, which resulted in no early screeners from film critics, leaving those responsible for the film in the dark to whether or not fans or the general public would have enjoyed the film, the X-Men will make their silver screen debut on the 14th of July, to a $296.3 million box office debut, making it the 6th highest grossing film of 2000. With various superhero comic book adaptations of the 90s being less than impressive and mostly doing more harm than good, it was definitely a breath of fresh air to see how, under the right type of people behind the scenes that understood the characters and their overall message of what they do, that a live-action film of a comic book property could be successful. With the success of Blade starring Wesley Snipes putting things back on track in terms of showing how a certain property could be successful if done right, the X-Men cemented that statement with its films, various sequels and spin-offs, creating a very profitable genre that has made Marvel a household name not just in comic books, but also in film, video games, and television. Although in later iterations the X-Men movies would slowly introduce the more colorful costumes, thanks to Spider-Man arriving 2 years later and showing that you can have the costumes that captured their comic book aesthetics without looking too goofy and embracing its comic book roots, you have to remember that this was the style at the time. With movies like The Matrix and the aforementioned Blade, I can completely understand why the team responsible for the films decided on the look of the outfits, as it felt like a reaction to those types of films. Would colorful outfits have worked then? We might never know, but as Disney is in full ownership of the X-Men franchise and we are awaiting their arrival into the Marvel Cinematic Universe, I believe that Kevin Feige and company to be the ones who will be able to usher in these heroes with something that looks well on film and honors as well as respects these outfits that these beloved characters have been known for. If you would like to explore more of these issues, I would greatly suggest watching Captain Christian's amazing X-Men Color and Costumes video on YouTube, in which he goes into full detail on how color and the design of the X-Men costumes create a sense of identity for each character. These costumes they wear are not just a uniform, but are a symbol of the team's unification, a sense of belonging that in return displays each member's individuality through its various designs and colors. Link will be in the description below. Now, I know amidst the controversy that director Bryan Singer is currently involved in, it has been difficult to throw some positive outlook into various things that he was responsible for. With current allegations of on-set tantrums, mood swings resulting in production being shut down, as well as drug and sexual abuse, to say he has casted a dark cloud over the X-Men franchise would be an understatement. Knowing this, I would rather focus on the really strong performances and character development that this film and future spin-offs were able to convey. With the abuse and hardship these characters dealt with on a daily basis, this movie was able to treat the characters and material with respect, creating something that pleased both fans and general audiences alike, especially in a film that ultimately compared to others of that genre, felt very short and rushed. With the film's success in ushering in a film franchise that would run for 20 years, you cannot overlook the fact that the X-Men cartoon was able to establish itself as a turning point for both animated storytelling and the superhero genre as a whole. The people behind this cartoon and its success showed that by having love for the characters and the message they believe in, that you can have something that pleases all audiences, be it those that know them well or have just discovered them for the very first time. It showed that you can tell captivating stories with a sprinkling of action while also expressing a message that resonates with so many all over the world. The storylines in the original comic book would discuss a wide variety of subjects that dealt with all too realistic problems, be it racism, various forms of hate and prejudice. The series itself would acknowledge these problems likewise by also calling out attention to these atrocities and various horrors created by man. Although yes, they had to change certain names of various groups and situations in order to get it through the network censors in order to have their story be told, but even in that, it did not hinder the overall message. The cartoon was able to convey the struggles of various groups and individuals that were being detested for who they are and the lifestyle they chose to live. Something that, for a Saturday morning cartoon or an American cartoon in general, was never really done well without coming off as preachy or dumbed down to appeal to children.
What did we ever do to you?
You were born. They're doing what? That does it. All right, wise guy. You and your freako comrades can just hit the road.
I don't understand. Is there a problem?
I have to serve you jerks from the college, but I ain't putting up with any trouble from their kind.
Skin color prejudice? That's so pathetic, it's almost quaint.
It ain't quaint. Who are you calling pathetic? You Mongols must be some kind of medical experiment.
I think you just insulted the woman I love, lowlife. Now, you can either apologize, or I'm gonna show you how intolerant I can be.
The series even went as far as talking about religion, with one of the most intriguing episodes involving one particular mutant, Kurt Wagner, aka Nightcrawler. A character with a demon-like appearance but very grounded by his faith. An interesting character with his own contrast that is able to have conversations with a famously irate and spiritually skeptical Wolverine about the love of God, the persistence of faith, and the old question of bad things happening to good people. A character that, because of his appearance, is hunted down but finds solace in a monastery that does not judge him and accepts him as their own. The episode discusses theology, which, at the time, was something that you would have never expected from almost any piece of television entertainment, let alone a Saturday morning cartoon. With the X-Men, themes of ostracization of oppressed minority groups were key to the stories, and this episode was no different in telling a captivating story.
We are like you and I, angry at the world, and ourselves. My pain drove me to seek God. Yours drove you away.
Don't tell me about God. What kind of God would let men do this to me?
Our ability to understand God's purpose is limited. But we take comfort in the fact that His love is limitless.
I used to buy into all that. But I've lived too long. And I've done too much.
Life will always be hard. I understand this better than most. Yet despite it all, people of every faith believe there is a God who loves them. Can so many be wrong? Open your heart, Herr Logan. Would it hurt so much to see the world through different eyes?
This pacifist mutant monk, whose conflict is not with the X-Men, who are in the midst of a ski trip in Germany, but with Father Reinhardt, a bigot monk who sees his fellow brother of the cloth as a defiler of his beliefs, and not his equal. Even though the townspeople act upon the chapel he calls home in violence, ultimately burning it down, Nightcrawler, instead of claiming vengeance upon the person responsible, opens his heart to forgive Father Reinhardt, and in that shows the error of his ways. The episode concludes with Nightcrawler gifting Wolverine a Bible that he's marked up, and in while our grouchy hero accepts in reluctantly, we see that Logan has indeed grown as a person by being able to learn about forgiveness and getting in touch with something that he once had in his life, something that gave him comfort at one time. He was able to find comfort through the meeting of this one individual, Nightcrawler. In closing, the team behind the X-Men animated series were able to tell some amazing half-hour complex stories that focused on various subjects that resonated with so many watching without insulting the viewer's intelligence. Something that Stan Lee set out to do during his tenure as a writer for Marvel that has become synonymous in the way their characters and the stories they tell are portrayed. Being about personal feelings, interpersonal relationships, conflict involving prejudice, racism, and bigotry, this series was able to tell captivating stories about people, all the while sprinkling in bits of action and superhero hijinks in that small 20 to 30 minute runtime. The X-Men animated series was different from most animated action-adventure shows because it was more about the lives of our characters, heroes and villains alike, rather than the ingenious plots of non-stop death-defying physical jeopardy. It wasn't important whether or not the bad guy succeeded in blowing up a local mall. What mattered most is how Wolverine deals with the pain of losing a friend, or Cyclops trying to confront a father who had deserted him as a child, or the inner turmoil that Rogue had to deal with by isolating herself in hopes of not hurting those around her with a mere touch. The show used its plot to showcase characters and their struggles, not the other way around, and never betrayed or compromised its comic book roots. A lot of credit has to be given by Eric LaWold and his talented staff of writers who were able to take the stories and ideas that were laid forth by Stan Lee, Jack Kirby, Len Wayne, Chris Claremont, John Byrne, Jim Lee, Neil Adams, Dave Cockrum, and honor them by taking the message that the X-Men represented in the comic book and running with it. All of the people that were involved with this show were very faithful to the comics, and at the same time were able to expand those stories in different directions. Through it all, amongst giant robot attacks, time-traveling assassins, or interstellar wars, they were able to tell amazing stories about people. In a world where a certain group of individuals are hated for who they are, going as far as being hunted down for existing, the X-Men were able to confront the world that told them they were less than when they themselves knew they were so much more. We all need heroes. That's part of the human condition. That is why we have the mythology that we have. Superheroes represent modern mythology. Larger-than-life characters who they themselves are as flawed as we are with their own struggles. Every culture has its gods and goddesses, people who right wrongs and triumph over evil. Whoever it might be it in the pages of Marvel comic, a DC comic, or what have you. Every culture has the need for someone who represents our hopes and aspirations, that kind of person we all aspire to be. It is in that series and comic book that the X-Men's struggle can resonate with so many. Being accepted into a world that hates and fears you because they themselves do not understand is something that anyone can connect with at any age in their life. One of the things that make X-Men so great is that the team teaches its members to use their powers and become better heroes, and in return use these powers to help their fellow man. They are an allegory for the marginalized and discriminated. This gives the X-Men much more meaning than your average comic book or Saturday morning cartoon. Generations of readers, as well as those watching the cartoon, have identified with these gifted individuals and their struggles because they mirrored the struggles they are currently going through or have gone through. They aren't just the most important team in Marvel history, but probably in comic and television history because of the message of equality and empowering the marginalized is more important than your basic villain of the week or intergalactic threat. This gifted team of writers, directors, animators were able to do so much in carrying the message that Charles Xavier and his X-Men believed in through the pages of Marvel Comics and onto television screens around the world that have made this series a much beloved piece of television history. Despite the hurdles that this cartoon had to go through in order to get through the network censors, they were able to tell some amazing stories that respected the source material and conveyed the message that so many talented writers of the comic since its inception were able to achieve. Be it this series as well as its various spin-offs through the years have shown that the X-Men are without a doubt one of the most beloved and inspiring groups of characters in both comic and animation history. Whatever version it might be, take a chance on it. And maybe, just maybe, you might like it too. Till then, this is Edgar Velasco saying, thank you so much, and remember when it comes to cartoons we grew up with, that to truly appreciate something you have to accept its strengths and its faults, no matter what they are, because when that happens you can appreciate how amazing it was, and how amazing it continues to be. Thank you so much, and I'll see you all next time.
The real question that people are quite clearly interested in is, what is it about these mutants that you're hearing about?
Now, before this committee can answer the question, should the government require mandatory registration of mutants? I feel it necessary to first define the mutant threat currently facing our nation. Now, what is a mutant? Where do they live? And why are they so dangerous?
You continue to insist that all mutants are evil when it is clear that there are those out there risking their lives daily to protect us.
I assume you are referring to the insurgent mutant faction, commonly known as the X-Men.
Insurgent is your opinion, Senator. What I want to know is, who is behind the X-Men?
I still have hope. Oh, yes. Hope. What about the rest of the world? Doesn't it ever wake you up in the middle of the night? The feeling that one day they'll come for you and your children.
Pity for the poor soul that comes to my school looking for trouble.
We'll be right back. rich man.